Tracy Sable. Tonight on EWTN News Nightly, Eye on Africa. The White House holds high-level meetings in the nation's capital. Food for thought. How Catholic Charities and other organizations are doing amid high inflation in the United States. Smartphones and a saint. Why the Jesuit order just released a new app. And a light in the darkness. Kayakers brave icy water to honor the feast of an early church martyr. These stories and more tonight.
From EWTN, the Global Catholic Network, this is EWTN News Nightly.
Thank you for being with us on the Feast of St. John of the Cross, our top story tonight. President Joe Biden signed the Respect for Marriage Act into law, but that did not quell the controversy. Catholic bishops expressed deep concern, and now other groups are speaking out as well. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen.
Good evening to you, Tracy. Tonight, this all comes down to religious freedom. Should Catholics and other Christians be forced to go against their faith to support same-sex weddings? Many say no.
But I see your true colors.
Chart-topping singers, cross-dressers, and an assortment of gay rights supporters all invited to the White House South Lawn to witness President Joe Biden sign the so-called Respect for Marriage Act into law.
We need to challenge the hundreds of callous, cynical laws introduced in the states targeting transgender children, terrifying families, and criminalizing doctors who give children the care they need.
The president challenged traditional beliefs and raised the ire of conservatives. America First Works executive director Ashley Hayek wrote, "America was built on the idea of freedom of religion, but the unnecessary Respect for Marriage Act threatens this fundamental protection. This is yet another egregious and deliberate attack on religious liberty by the radical left." Chad Wolf from the America First Policy Institute agrees. He says the new law puts every American's foundational religious liberties at risk. Also, the U.S.-Africa Leaders Summit continues. About 60% of Africa's population is under age 25. Today, President Biden addressed business leaders.
This forum is about building connections. It's about closing deals. And above all, it's about the future, our shared future.
The Biden administration trying to convince Africa it can count on the U.S. to be there, and that democracy is far better than autocracy.
Because when Africa succeeds, the United States succeeds. Quite frankly, the whole world succeeds as well.
Meanwhile, 10 years ago, the massacre at Sandy Hook, President Biden writing, 20 young children with their whole lives ahead of them, six educators who gave their lives protecting their students. We have a moral obligation to pass and enforce laws that can prevent these things from happening again.
Now back to the U.S.-Africa Leaders Summit. All those heads of state, some 49 of them and their spouses, will come to the White House tonight for dinner. Then tomorrow there will be high-level discussions among leaders before they depart. At the White House, Owen Jensen, EWTN News Nightly.
Lawmakers have struck a deal on a framework to fund the government into October of 2023, but it could be derailed by several unresolved issues. Republicans want to increase defense spending. Democrats want more for domestic priorities for the massive $1.7 trillion proposal. Capitol Hill correspondent Eric Rosales joins us now with the latest. Eric.
Well, good evening, Tracy. You know, the first step here is to keep the government open past Friday. Lawmakers can then iron out specifics. Right now, they're targeting funding extension until December 23rd. Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell warned that the funding package must pass before the holidays.
This needs to be finished no later than late evening on the 22nd. We intend to be on the road going home on the 23rd. We intend not to be back here between Christmas and New Year's.
Majority Leader Chuck Schumer says passing an omnibus bill is the best way forward.
An omnibus remains the best and most responsible option to ensure we have all the resources we need to serve the American people at full capacity like they deserve.
Leader Schumer adds that millions more for Ukraine and a bipartisan election reform bill are included in the package. Some Republicans don't support a huge catch-all bill. They want a short-term extension until early next year so the new Congress can pass a budget. Senator John Kennedy tells me he won't vote for a massive spending bill.
What's your reaction to this? I mean, at the last minute, and having you all to say go
with it. Every member of the United States Congress ought to put a paper bag over their head. The leaders who do this to us, and the rest of us who allow it to be done.
Senator Kennedy also called out House and Senate leaders, including Republican Mitch McConnell, for not getting the budget done on time back in October. House Republicans say they plan to control spending when they take over majority in January.
We've been spending money like drunken sailors in this country since the beginning of the pandemic, and Republicans want to go back to pre-pandemic spending debates, and the sooner we have that and get the ship righted, the better.
The House is expected to approve the one-week continuing resolution tonight. The Senate will likely pass it on Thursday. Now, specific defense and domestic spending amounts in the framework will be worked out over the next couple of weeks. I'll stay on top of the issue. At the Capitol, Eric Rosales, EWTN News Nightly.
Governor Mark Ouellette has filed a defamation lawsuit in response to claims of sexual abuse. He was named last summer in a class action case against the Archdiocese of Quebec. An initial Vatican review found insufficient evidence against the cardinal, who adamantly denies the charges. In Nicaragua, a Catholic bishop remains under house arrest. He is facing charges of conspiracy and spreading false news. A hearing for Bishop Rolando Alvarez is set for early January. A warrant also has been issued for a priest who has reportedly left the Central American country. While global leaders gather at the U.S.-Africa summit in Washington, D.C., we bring you tonight the story of a Nigerian teenager named Leah. Leah Sharibu's Kwai village of Dapchi, Nigeria, was attacked by jihadist terrorists in 2018. Leah and about 100 of her classmates were abducted, some of them killed. Most of the girls returned home, but not Leah. And joining us tonight in our studio with the rest of Leah's story is Dr. Gloria Puldu, president of the Leah Foundation. Dr. Puldu, thank you so much for coming on today. We appreciate your time. For those who aren't familiar with her story, tell us a little bit more about Leah and what happened to her and her classmates.
I was 14 years old on February 19, 2018. When her secondary school in Dapchi village in Yobe state in Nigeria, northeastern part of Nigeria, was attacked by Boko Haram. And so they took 110 of the girls. And after 1 month of their abduction, you know, the federal government was able to negotiate for the release of the girls. And then all the girls came back. Unfortunately, five of them died on the way, the day they took them, because of how they were cramped in the cars and all that. So 104 of them got back. And where is Leah? And they said, Leah is still in captivity. Why? Because she refused to renounce Jesus. And we were shocked.
Yeah.
She was the only Christian girl among them. And then when Boko Haram asked, is there a Christian among you? Leah rose up and then shot her hand up and said, yes, I'm a Christian. And her friends were pulling it down. No, don't say that. She said, no, I'm a Christian. And they said, you're a Christian, come out here. And they told her to renounce her Christian faith, to recite what they call the Kalma Shahada, which is the Islamic creed. Leah boldly and courageously at 14 years old looked at this terrorist and said, I will not deny Jesus. And immediately we heard that. Yeah, we were heartbroken, but we were joyous that a young girl can face these people and speak. Meanwhile, the whole of that area, schools have been attacked. We know of the Chibok girls that were taken in 2014. Over 100 of them are still there. 8 years down the lane, Leah is almost 5 years now still there. She knew of that, but then she was bold enough to say yes.
So what is her situation right now? What is, you know, what are the updates? What do you know? How's her condition?
Her situation now, it's, you know, from eyewitnesses that were there, some of the girls that were also captured, and somehow they find themselves escape. When they come back, then we interview them, and they tell us she's still alive, even though she has two children now. Different men, because usually when they are taken, they just make them slaves And that was what Leah was.
And I understand her family, they haven't given up hope. They're still searching for her, trying to get her release. Talk to us about her family, also how they're doing during this time.
You know, for us, not just the family, the whole country in Nigeria, the Christians will not forget Leah. Talk less of her parents. Her mom especially is on a daily basis being encouraged by the prayer of people and the love she gets all around her, you know, encouraging her about the fate of her daughter and the courage that she had. And so that is giving them hope and it's making them to hold on to life.
What about the government? I mean, has the government of Nigeria intervened at any point to try to free her?
He has not fulfilled that promise. Leah, February 2023, she will be 5 years in captivity if she doesn't get released.
And he's here. The president of Nigeria is here in the United States right now for the U.S.-Africa summit. Do you think this will come up in any of the talks?
For us, we know that it will be very difficult for it to come up. And why did I say it will be difficult for it to come up? I know that the U.S. will want to concentrate on the economy, will want to concentrate on other aspects. But with the religious freedom of what is happening in Nigeria, it is difficult. Why? Because Nigeria has been removed from the list of countries of particular concern by United States of America, and this is the second year. You know, it's very sad for us as Christians to see that genocide is happening to us. People are being killed on a daily basis. Just in 1 year, 6,006 people, Christians, were slaughtered. Villages and all these reports are out there, and yet the Nigerian government, the United States government, delisted Nigeria from that list. So we don't expect anything coming out even from this concerning the persecution of Christians, and who's Leah Sharibu is the face of that persecution. So for us, it's really sad. We call on the United States government, Blinken, Biden, to do the right thing, because they shouldn't deny the genocide that is happening in Nigeria, and genocide of Christians is happening.
Yeah, and Dr. Puldu, before I let you go, we're almost out of time, but what else would you like our audience to know?
Yeah, I would want to ask that everybody continue to pray for us. Speak out to your representatives. You have new Congress coming on. We had tried the past 4 years meeting the others so that we can, and they were able to place Nigeria, but it has been removed. Please speak to your congressmen and your senators. Let them place back Nigeria and hold Nigeria accountable. And also ask them, the aids that you are giving to them, where is the money going? Is it sponsoring terrorism or what?
Dr. Puldu, thank you so much for coming on and speaking to us about all this. Very important. We appreciate it, and God bless you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. God bless you, too.
We have a lot more still to come here on EWTN News Nightly, including how inflation is affecting supplies at food banks. And Pope Francis explains why remaining on guard is important for followers of Christ. For staying with us, food banks across the nation are feeling the pinch, with more people in need of a helping hand as the price of eggs, butter, and milk remain sky high. According to new data released this week, over the past 2 years, average prices paid by American families has shot up 13.8%, leading to longer lines and more hungry mouths at many charities across the U.S., including Catholic food banks. And joining us tonight is Monsignor John Enzler, president of Catholic Charities of the Archdiocese of Washington. Monsignor Enzler, always good to be with you. I know that you have a bird's eye view of a pretty large operation. What's it like out there in terms of our Catholic food banks and other Catholic charity operations?
What you just expressed in terms of some of the difference in inflation for people, it's really real. So, you know, eggs, milk, poultry, things like that, all those things are more expensive, which means that many people are not getting quality meals. They might be getting some staples, but because of that, our food pantries continue to grow and expand our service to people who are much in need. So it's a real concern for us.
Yeah, and how does the situation compare to last year? I mean, are you seeing more people in need with these food prices up and the economy, as we know, on the fritz?
I think we thought, Catholic Charities here in Washington, D.C., that we would be, once we got the pandemic pretty much under control, and that's not over, but under control as it was, that would be numbers would go down. They're not going down very much. In fact, I think they went down a little dip for a while. Now they're back up again. Last year, we served almost 3 million meals in food pantries and food banks. And so it's a fairly substantial operation in many different places. And in fact, I say it's, and if people come to us, they say, but we can't get the stuff we need. We can't get the food we'd like to have. And so they come to us and tell us the stories of how they're here because last year they could do it themselves. Now they want the resources. They come to us for help.
And what about you all? I mean, what are your supply levels like? Anything that you need right now?
We're pretty lucky in the fact that people are really generous with food. I think the key issue is nutritious food. You know, a normal food bank might have staple foods like cereal or canned food or other types of food. We try many of our efforts to make sure we've got produce as well and poultry as well, as we serve people actually meat and vegetables and the food that is more nutritious for them. It costs more, but it also means they're being fed in a way that's more nutritious for themselves and their families.
If people watching right now, if they would like to help out, how can they do so? And what's best? Should they donate food? Should they donate money?
I'd say if this is across the country, if any place, if you've got an ability to support people through your parishes, any parishes that food drives run this year, as well as the Catholic Charities and wherever you are, but also just in terms of us here in Washington, we can always use support to do a better job we're doing. The reality is that we always need more funding, which for some people, it's easier. We write a check, and that means we have a chance to be able to be served. Others, they'd like to do the actual getting the food. That's fine as well. Whatever helps you to get involved in hungry. Now, the Lord tells us to feed the hungry, and this is a chance for us to do so in the whatever way is best for you. We should do it because it's part of our mission, gospel mission, to serve those in need.
Absolutely. And before I let you go, Monsignor, we're almost out of time, but I understand retirement is on the horizon for you. Any thoughts as you look back on your priesthood, in particular your time at Catholic Charities?
I'll be 50 years a priest coming May, and I'll be stepping down as president and CEO of Catholic Charities in D.C. at that time. I will not be retiring in terms of, I'm not going to Florida and read a book. I'll be working here as much as possible, other things as well, helping Catholic Charities behind the scenes. But the important thing is the mission in my heart and the passion I have for those in need will always continue. I might not be in charge of it, but I'll be helping to make sure it happens. That to me is a wonderful runway through retirement to make sure I'm doing the things I'm called to do.
Yeah, and we thank you for your service and your ministry and all that you've done. Thank you so much. God bless you, and Merry Christmas to you, Monsignor.
Merry Christmas to you, and thank you. Just one more quick thing I want to say.
Sure.
God's in charge of Catholic Charities, I'm convinced. It's a quick story that might be helpful. Our SHARE program, which does food packs with people, it was in trouble financially before COVID, really in trouble. We have a hard time making it work. COVID comes along, and we have a warehouse, and we have refrigerators, and we have freezers, and all of a sudden, our food production and distribution goes way up because of that. So that was God. Mm-hmm. We were about ready to say, that program doesn't work. God's done, not the COVID, but God made sure we were available and ready with helping hands for those in need. To me, I look and see how God does so much, so many ways. I'm clearly convinced that God's in charge of all we do.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing that story with us, and thank you for all that you do, Monsignor. Again, we appreciate it.
Thank you. Merry Christmas to you as well. Merry Christmas.
Well, up next on EWTN News Nightly, 'tis the season for nativity scenes, including one that is going to be washed up soon. Plus, this year's Christmas parade in one European city that made quite the splash, we'll explain. Pope Francis reminds the faithful that a good disciple is always vigilant.
Non è vigilante, non è attento, perché è troppo sicuro di sé.
In his weekly talk to pilgrims at the Vatican, the Holy Father says we can lose many graces by not guarding against temptation. He also says when we trust too much in ourselves and not in God's grace, the evil one finds an open door to reach us. A new smartphone application or app will teach users about the life and writings of Saint Ignatius of Loyola. The Jesuit Pilgrimage uses 360-degree photographs plus audio and text meditations to tell people more about the founder of the Society of Jesus. The app, developed by the Jesuits, is free. It is available in English, French, Italian, and Spanish. We go now to Father Vivian Richard, Communication Officer at the Jesuit Curia. Father Richard, thank you so much for joining us today. I'm curious, why did your order decide to use smartphones in order to teach people about Saint Ignatius?
Thank you, Tracy, for having me here at EWTN in the first place. And we are very excited about the app release. And to answer your question, why we went on smartphones, and to answer precisely that question, that's what people use every day. And we have almost everyone in the world using the smartphone. And it has more accessibility for people to use these kind of material on the saint of Saint Ignatius of Loyola. We have a lot of material on books. We have a lot of material here in the library and in most of the retreat houses. And to give all of them a good digital version is why we went for the smartphone version. And it would have another opportunity for people to use them wherever they go. And whenever they visit some churches, any pilgrim places of St. Ignatius, they can always open their smartphone and listen to the prayer meditations that we have in the smartphone. So this is one of the reasons why we precisely went for a smartphone edition of the Pilgrims app.
Yeah, very smart indeed. And Father, tell us more about the app. I mean, how does it work? How can people find it?
Well, the name of the app is Jesuit Pilgrimage, and this is precisely an audio, it is precisely an spiritual guide for anyone who wants to journey with Ignatius to all the places that is connected to his life. So this app starts from Loyola, his birthplace, and all the way to Rome, where he died. And we can have a wonderful pilgrimage following the life of St. Ignatius of Loyola. And more precisely, we have photos and 360-degree pictures of all the places of St. Ignatius lived and worked. And this is, again, a very special edition of the app. And more precisely, we have audio recorded in this app in four languages. We have in English, we have in Spanish, Italian, and French. So it's for wider people to use this app, and we are excited about this app, in fact. And we precisely kept the name as Jesuit Pilgrimage and not as Ignatian Pilgrimage because later on we will be adding more saints from the Society of Jesus so that we have a lot more people using the app and have a spiritual experience wherever they go.
Yeah, that sounds so wonderful. What's your hope for people when they use the app? And also, what's been the response so far? What have you been hearing?
Well, it's been just 2 days we have launched this app for the public release on the Play Store and App Store. And already we have like 2,000 downloads. And all the responses that we're getting from people are excellent. They are very happy about the app. And it gives each one of them a spiritual atmosphere to journey in the life of St. Ignatius of Loyola. And one of the greatest hopes that we have from the communications office is that this prayer app will lead people closer to God, and just as it led St. Ignatius of Loyola in his spiritual journey. And we are hoping that this spiritual journey will enhance the spiritual life of all the people who have this app. And we can use this app in very many ways, in fact. We can use this app as a screencast on a television, so it can be used for, you know, a small prayer group in the family or for students in the classroom, for youth animation. And it can also serve as an on-site guide whenever you visit Rome or any other places that's connected to the life of St. Ignatius. So it's Jesuit Pilgrimage, whether you're at home or on a journey, it's a wonderful spiritual guide to experience the life of St. Ignatius.
Absolutely. And Father, thank you so much for speaking to us about this. We really appreciate it. God bless you.
Thank you so much.
An artist in England has created a giant nativity scene, one that may wind up underwater. The beachfront nativity scene is a fundraiser for local churches. The artist was joined by volunteers last Sunday to rake the design onto the sand. A drone captured the beautiful views, which were converted into digital photographs to become thank you gifts for donors. Very neat. Well, finally tonight, bringing light into darkness, hundreds of kayakers celebrate St. Lucy's feast day in Denmark. The heavily bundled carolers sang Christmas tunes as they drifted through the canals of Copenhagen. One participant called the 12th annual parade, quote, dark, cold, and very beautiful, beautiful indeed. And we thank you for watching tonight. Remember, you can follow us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at EWTN News Nightly. I'm Tracy Sable. Good night, and God bless.
Thank you.